Okay, this one gets a little bit more involved in a few different areas of halacha, but the question is a lawyer, a Jewish lawyer, you know, who keeps halacha, is he allowed to draft an advance directive for another Jewish person that includes removal from life support, right? When some people, when they are getting older, so they, or even younger, they write up how they want the hospitals and doctors to deal with them, you know, should problems arise. And, you know, some people say, if I, you know, reach a certain state of, you know, inactivity, so I want you to remove me from life support. Now, that stage of inactivity very often is still alive, according to halacha, meaning, you know, a person who's in a coma is completely alive, according to halacha, and removing them from life support is considered to be murder. So the question is a lawyer, a Jewish lawyer, allowed to draft an advance directive, which is basically allowing this person to potentially be murdered? And the question is one of lifnei iver, right? In other words, if we have this, you know, idea lifnei iver lo sitein michshol, if somebody can't do something on their own, and I help them do it, so I'm accountable for it as well. So this person can't write up their advance directive by themselves, and they're coming to me to do it, and if I could say no, so, you know, I'm not going to be helping them to do this avera. So is that mutar or not? So for starters, if it's possible to let somebody else do it, most of the poskim that I've discussed this with said it's better to let somebody else do it and to stay away from it, you know, if you can. If it's a person's parnasa and this is what they do and there's no other choice, so there's a number of reasons why we can be lenient on this, according to, you know, many of the poskim that I've discussed this with. First of all, it's not lifnei iver. Lifnei iver is an issur d'oraisa, right? When I'm the one who's causing a person to do an avera, that's aser min ha-Torah. However, Chazal tell us that lifnei iver is only in a scenario when, without me, this person won't be able to get it. The example is Trey Avri Danahara. You've got two sides of a river, and you've got a nazir on one side, and you've got a cup of wine on the other side, and the only way the wine is going to get from here to here is if I pass it across the river to the nazir. That's Lifnei Iver. But let's say the nazir can cross over the river himself, or the nazir has another bottle of wine available to him. It's just easier, and he's asking me for mine. That's now still Aser. It's still Aser to do Midrabanan. That's an Iser called Misayeya. It's helping a person do an Avera. But again, this Iser is Midrabbana, not Min HaTorah. Min HaTorah, there's this Iser of Lifnei Iver. That's only if they can't do it without me. If the person can get to the Avera without me, then it lowers it to this level of Misayeya. I'm not allowed to help another Jew do a sin, right? But it's not like I'm the one causing him to do it because he could do it without me. Okay. Still Aser, though. However, this Iser of Misayeya, there's a very big machlokas in Yoredeya between the Gedolei Achronim, between the Shach and the Dagon Revava, about this idea whether Misayeya applies to a non-religious person. According to many Rishonim, the understanding of Misayeya, you know, has to do either with a mitzvah of Tochacha or Arvus or whatever the basis is. Those ideas in Halacha generally only apply to other religious people, right? A person who is not religious, we don't have a mitzvah of Tochacha to them if they're not going to change and nothing's going to happen. So the Shach writes that there's a room to be lenient, that there's no Iser of Misayeya when we're talking about a person who is not from a person who's not religious anyway, and, you know, doesn't care about the halacha anyway. So, you know, again, I can't do lifnei iver. I can't be the cause of them doing an avera, but helping them do an avera that they're for sure going to do anyway, that they don't care about anyway. So the Shach is lenient about that. However, there's a reason why this might not apply here. Many poskim say this does not apply to a tinok shenishba. This leniency in the Shach is really, they say, only applies to a person who knows what he's doing and knows that it's an avera and knows that it's wrong, like a mumar. But a person who is a tinok shenishba, a person who was brought up not religious and doesn't know the difference, so, you know, many poskim say that the Shach does not apply over there. Okay, so that's question one. That's outstanding. It's an issue of misayeya, and according to some, the Shach is lenient in the case of misayeya, even when it's a tinok shenishba. Another one is the Shailas Juvas Meshiv Davar, who writes that there's no Iser of Misayeya when it is being paid, when a person is being paid for it, that then there's no Misayeya. Misayeya is only when, like, I help another Jew do something, but if I'm being paid to do it, and again, if he could get it elsewhere, if he could do it elsewhere, then there's no Iser of Misayeya. So, he, you know, some of the poskim added this in. Finally, one of the Dayanim said that this is a safek if it'll ever happen, right? In other words, it's not for sure going to be that this is going to end up doing any lifnei iver or misayei at all, right? It's possible that this one person is going to, you know, die in a car accident or some other way, in which case it's not going to be pertinent at all, this whole document. So the whole thing to begin with is only a safek whether it's actually misayei or not. So again, if a person can get out of doing these types of things, that's the best. However, halacha l'maisa, again, you should ask a shayla on a case-by-case basis. However, a number of dayanim and poskim were lenient in a case where a person needs this for their panasa and they don't have another choice, based on these couple of things put together, the shach and the tinuk shmit and the tinuk shnishpa, leniency, as well as the other things that we mentioned.